India is planning something big, and it's called the National River Linking Project. Imagine redirecting the flow of nature itself by connecting 37 rivers from the Himalayas to the Bay of Bengal, moving 200 billion cubic meters of water annually. That's enough to fill 80 million Olympic-sized swimming pools every year. India's National River Linking Project is a shining example of human ingenuity by delivering water from river basin regions in surplus to areas of deficit across India each year. This massive undertaking will clock in at $168 billion and promises to be an engineering feat unlike anything the world has ever seen before. On paper, it sounds promising. More water for drought-hit areas, increased farmland, boost in power generation. But here's the catch. Interlinking rivers can change India's weather. I had a chat with Dr. Tejasvi Chauhan, a water engineer at the Max Planck Institute, who is also the first author of this study, which details the impact river interlinking in India would have on India's weather patterns, particularly the monsoon season. And he shared some eye-opening facts. Firstly, 80% of India's fresh water supply comes from the monsoon season. And of that 80%, 60% is lost to the ocean because there's not enough infrastructure like dams and reservoirs to catch and store all that precious water for the dry times. That's where this big river linking plan comes in. The idea is to connect river basins to redistribute the flow of water evenly throughout the nation. But here's the thing. In order to pull this off, you would need to know which rivers are in surplus and which are in deficit to correctly redirect water from areas of flooding to areas of drought. And turns out, this information, river water flow data, is a state secret in India.
Because I remember trying to get water for discharge data for Ganga Basin, it's quite confidential, it's not public. And I don't know what's the reason behind it.
No one really knows why it's a state secret, although we have a few guesses. For context, India has been having river water disputes since it gained independence back in 1947. During the partition of British India, border lines were drawn to define what is called the Indus watershed, which sanctioned India's control of upstream barrages, which ultimately regulated flow into Pakistan. The issue is 90% of Pakistan's food and 65% of its employment depend on farming and husbandry that is sustained by the Indus River. This causes severe tensions mainly between India and Pakistan and puts a chokehold on any dam projects for fear that India will use its upstream dams to control water flow downstream into Pakistan via the Indus and vice versa. But river water disputes are also constantly happening within India too. One of the biggest and longest river disputes in the nation has been between Tamil Nadu and Karnataka over the Kaveri River.
The government will ensure that justice will be done to the people of Karnataka, for the farmers of Karnataka.
We cannot see a slave like DMK, which is to Congress, which refuses to give water.
A dispute that dates back to the 1890s during the time of the British Raj. The Kaveri River is often referred to as the Ganga of the South. It is a major interstate river in South India that originates in Karnataka and passes through Tamil Nadu, Kerala, and Pondicherry before draining into the Bay of Bengal. For these states, the Kaveri River serves as a lifeline and is a source of drinking water, irrigation, and power generation. But unlike the northern rivers, which are fed by glaciers, the Kaveri River relies on monsoon rainfall for its water supply. This will come into play later, so remember this. Karnataka contributes 425,000 million cubic feet of water, while Tamil Nadu contributes 252,000 million cubic feet of water to the river's flow. The issue is that the distribution of water decided back in 1892 and 1924 don't match these contributions, creating the crux of this conflict. The 1892 agreement simply allocated water from the Gauri River between the two states. It's the 1924 agreement that is still causing headlines even 100 years later in 2024. This agreement favored Tamil Nadu, allocating a significant 75% of river water to the state and only 23% to Karnataka until 1974. But that all changed after independence in 1947. Both states' economies strongly rely on water-heavy agricultural crops like rice and sugarcane, and thus want a more piece of the pie. So in 1990, the central government of India set up the Gauri Water Disputes Tribunal to settle the dispute and redid the water allocations. The issue here is that increasingly irregular rainfall during the monsoon season has led to critically low water levels in the Gauri Basin. For example, last September, the Supreme Court asked Karnataka to release 5,000 cubic feet per second of water to Tamil Nadu for 15 days. This led to farmer protests in Karnataka because the region suffered an overall rainfall deficit of 53.42%. At the same time, Tamil Nadu relies on Karnataka's water release for their crop irrigation, and without it, crop failure is a major concern. Ultimately, rainfall unpredictability magnifies the challenges of managing water resources effectively. So what do? You manually interlink rivers. By the way, it's important to note that this river linking project isn't new. In fact, this plan is nearly 100 years in the making. In 1858, a British military engineer named Arthur Thomas Cotton came up with an even more ambitious proposal to connect all major rivers in India to combat drought. He retired shortly after, so his plan wasn't seen through. But ever since, this river interlinking project has been gathering dust until 2014, when newly sworn in Prime Minister Modi revived the river plan.
Atalji ne नदियों को जोड़ने का विजन रखा था मकसद यही था कि जिन नदियों में जरूरत से ज्यादा पानी है उसको सूखाग्रस्त क्षेत्रों तक पहुंचाया जा सके.
With his water minister famously declaring the river linking project would be achieved within the decade. It famously was not completed in a decade, but the project has been fast-tracked this year under Modi. In fact, the Indian government already received clearance to move forward with the first link in the grid, which would connect the Ken and Betwa rivers in central India. We'll get back to the politics of this later on in the video because it's a large reason why this story isn't really making headlines. But a more pressing question is, how can redirecting a river change India's weather? As I mentioned at the top of the video, 80% of India's fresh water supply comes from the monsoon. But the thing is, this water is not uniformly distributed across India. There is spatial variability, meaning some regions may receive higher than average amounts of water, while other regions may receive less. That's what leads to floods in some places and droughts in other places, like in Bengaluru, which recently experienced one of its worst droughts in 40 years. Ironically, Bengaluru used to be known as the City of a Thousand Lakes, but due to urbanization, the majority of these lakes were filled to make way for commercial buildings and so on, and there currently isn't enough infrastructure to hold the water that does come. So where does this water go? When it rains, the water gets drained back into the ocean, either to the Arabian Sea or Bay of Bengal.
The whole central idea, like I said, of this river interlinking scheme, the whole philosophy behind is to make sure that we keep maximum water on land. Don't let it go into the ocean before we use it.
But there's another glaring issue with this plan, according to Dr. Chauhan. It assumes that India's river basins are separate entities and don't interact with one another. But that actually isn't true. India's river basins are constantly interacting with one another and are connected through the water cycle. It's called land atmosphere feedback, and it's pretty cool. It essentially has to do with evaporation, which happens in any river basin. For example, a big agricultural area in India is in the Ganga Basin, where flood irrigation water is used for watering crops. Most of that water evaporates into the atmosphere.
Originally, it had come from the ocean, we kept it, we held it, we put it on, we supplied it as irrigation, and then it went back into the atmosphere, not to the ocean, but again rained back. That's what's called recycled precipitation.
Meaning the water in one local Indian river might actually be recycled rain from hundreds of miles away. This is important information because it means that India's river basins are already interconnected naturally without manual interlinking. Now, what would happen if you forcefully interconnect these river basins? That's what Dr. Chauhan built a predictive model to find out. His hypothesis was that if you increase the amount of water in areas which previously did not receive water before, it could potentially alter the natural water cycle. And he found that there is a change in rainfall all over India during the monsoon season, particularly in September.
The problem was that the September is a critical month. The water availability during September decides what post-monsoon in the month of October, November, how much water are you going to have.
And there was something else. An increase in irrigation across the country could also lower India's overall temperature, which could throw off critical temperature gradients between land and ocean needed for the entire monsoon system.
I mean, there needs to be a temperature gradient for winds to come over to India. If you cool the land down, this gradient may reduce, so which can lead to lesser amount of water coming from the ocean. That's the one possible pathway.
And this is because of something called land surface processes, and also the key message of this video, that weather is not independent of land. Dr. Chauhan reiterates that his study is just one aspect of river interlinking's impact on the water cycle, irrigation. But there are many more.
There's full surface energy balance, how land interacts with the atmosphere. Each aspect can be studied, each aspect can contribute to processes.
And apart from the water cycle, there's the whole ecological side of the story. Beyond potentially disrupting the water cycle in India, just the first link of this project is expected to submerge large areas of a critical tiger reserve, kill more than 2 million trees, and harm key animal species such as Indian vultures, which are only just recovering from being nearly wiped out at 99.9%. In short, this entire river linking project needs a full EIA, something called an environmental impact assessment, to investigate the ecological aspects, demographic aspects, and every other aspect that needs to be considered. Because every time a reservoir is built, some displacement more or less happens because civilizations, by nature, settle around rivers. Dr. Chauhan doesn't have an estimate of how many could be displaced, but others estimate it could displace around 500,000 people. So then I asked Dr. Chauhan, has anyone in the Indian government tried to contact you after your study came out?
No. I mean, I haven't received any communication from the government. But what impression I have is that there are links. Means this project is divided into some links, some phases. So even first phase is not finished. All the rest of the phases are already in the EIA stage, impact assessment stage. So perhaps those guys, our study just serves as a communication that there's a hydrologic aspect as well. Other than ecologic or something like that. So perhaps they will take into account, but I haven't received any communication.
Because an EIA is great, but if you're going to significantly disrupt the water flow of India, you would think you'd want to consult a water expert. Chances are the majority of you watching this video are hearing about the real impacts of India's river interlinking project for the first time. This story is not making any headlines, and there's a reason for that. And it has to do with the fact that historically, climate change has not been an election issue in India. For context, the 2019 national elections was the first time that climate change was featured in the manifestos of the two major parties, the BJP and the Congress. Now, that isn't to say that India's major political parties don't talk about climate change at all. They do. Climate conversation is not missing in India, it's just different. It's not packaged and presented neatly as climate change as it is in the West. The term climate change just doesn't resonate with the majority of the nation. But if you present climate change in terms of more tangible events of day-to-day life, then you can get more people to understand it. But it's more than that. India still believes the brown agenda is more pressing than the green agenda. The brown agenda refers to India's quest for basic needs for its nation, such as food, clothing, and shelter. There is overlap with the environment there when it comes to clean drinking water, sanitation, and drainage. But even among millennial Indians, climate change was only the fourth most important issue for them, after employment, inflation, and taxes. A 2022 study found that between 1999 and 2019, only 0.3% of questions raised by politicians were about climate change. This revelation gave me an entirely new perspective. Being able to focus on climate policies is a luxury and a privilege that some countries just don't have. In many ways, it's a first world problem, as odd as that might sound. Because the truth of the matter is, lifting millions of people out of poverty remains a Herculean task and priority for India. But that is changing as India becomes one of the fastest growing economies in the world.
The world is going through a crucial transformation. There is a growing realization that climate change is not just a matter of the future.
It is now being climate smart by pairing climate policies with traditional big political ticket items like social or welfare issues, spinning environmental protection and preservation as necessary actions to ensure good farming, water, and sanitation without labeling it as an environmental agenda. And after being reelected, PM Modi did restate his commitment to bring forth a green era in India.
India is committed towards creating cleaner and greener planet. We were the first among G20 nations to fulfill our Paris commitments on green energy.
In the meantime, if river interlinking is not a viable solution, then what is?
Rigorous studies could be done for nature-based solutions, water harvesting, some things like that. They have not been explored to their potential also. These kinds of strategies. And perhaps they are less damaging to the environment as well.
Dr. Chauhan also points out that it's a matter of perspective of whether or not you want to conduct water management in a centralized way.
River interlinking, in some way, if you think about it, it'll be a centralized system. The whole water for a basin will be managed from a dam reservoir, which needs to be there. So what rainwater harvesting does is, essentially you're aiming for the same, philosophically same solution, that you want to keep maximum water on land, prevent it from going away, but your reservoirs are really small and decentralized. So every house will have a small reservoir for its own, something like that. So these are two sides of the whole story. So I think there needs to be a balance between these two. Perhaps that's the sweet spot.
I think we all know inherently that everything in nature is connected, but this is the hard scientific evidence that everything is truly not only connected, but dependent on one another. And altering the natural order of things comes at a cost. Dr. Chauhan's river linking research opened my mind to a new possibility. With more droughts occurring across the globe, will more governments be looking to follow in India's footsteps to alter our natural waterways? And that's exactly why this topic is so important, because it's not just about India. It's a cautionary tale to all governments about the unintended consequences of large-scale environmental manipulation. As more droughts occur across the world from global warming, this story also offers a glimpse into the future of a world where water is scarce and the lengths humans might go to reshape the very face of the Earth, for better or worse. If you want to learn more about this river linking project, check out the links in the description below. And thanks for watching. This is part of a three-part series on Earth Day, so make sure that you're subscribed to Today I Learned Science so you don't miss a single episode.